This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book The Evolution of Modern Medicine by William Osler. Chapter 1: Origin of Medicine. Introduction. Sail to the Pacific with some ancient mariner, and traverse day by day that silent sea until you reach a region never before furrowed by keel, where a tiny island, a mere speck on the vast ocean, has just risen from the depths. A little coral reef, capped with green, an atoll, a mimic earth, fringed with life, built up through countless ages by life on the remains of life that has passed away. And now, with wings of fancy, join Ianthe in the magic car of Shelley, pass the eternal gates of the flaming ramparts of the world, and see his vision. Below lay stretched the boundless universe. There, far as the remotest line, that limits swift imagination's flight. Unending orbs mingled in mazy motion. Immutably fulfilling eternal nature's law. Above, below, around. The circling systems formed. A wilderness of harmony. Demon of the world, part. I. And somewhere, as fast and far the chariot flew, amid the mighty globes would be seen a tiny speck, Earth's distant orb, one of the smallest lights that twinkle in the heavens. Alighting, Ianthe would find something she had probably not seen elsewhere in her magic flight, life, everywhere encircling the sphere. And as the little coral reef out of a vast depth had been built up by generations of polyzoa, so she would see that on the Earth, through illimitable ages, successive generations of animals and plants had left in stone their imperishable records, and at the top of the series she would meet the thinking, breathing creature known as man. Infinitely little as is the architect of the atoll in proportion to the earth on which it rests, the polyzoon, I doubt not, is much larger relatively than is man in proportion to the vast systems of the universe, in which he represents an ultra-microscopic atom less 10,000 times than the tiniest of the gay motes that people the sunbeams. Yet, with colossal audacity, this thinking atom regards himself as the anthropocentric pivot around which revolve the eternal purposes of the universe. Knowing not whence he came, why he is here, or whither he is going, man feels himself of supreme importance and certainly is of interest to himself. Let us hope that he has indeed a potency and importance out of all proportion to his somatic insignificance. We know of toxins of such strength that an amount too infinitesimal to be gauged may kill, and we know that the unit adopted in certain scientific work is the amount of emanation produced by 1,000,000,000th of a grain of radium, a quantity which itself has a volume of less than 1,000,000,000th of a cubic millimeter and weighs 1,000,000,000 times less than an exceptionally delicate chemical balance will turn to, Saadi, 1912. May not man be the radium of the universe? At any rate, let us not worry about his size. For us he is a very potent creature, full of interest, whose mundane story we are only beginning to unravel. Civilization is but a filmy fringe on the history of man. Go back as far as his records carry us, and the story written on stone is of yesterday in comparison with the vast epochs of time which modern studies demand for his life on the earth. For 2 millions, some hold even 3 millions, of years, man lived and moved and had his being in a world very different from that upon which we look out. There appear indeed to have been various types of man, some as different from us as we are from the anthropoid apes. What upstarts of yesterday are the pharaohs in comparison with the men who survived the tragedy of the glacial period? The ancient history of man, only now beginning to be studied, dates from the Pliocene or Miocene period. The modern history, as we know it, embraces that brief space of time that has elapsed since the earliest Egyptian and Babylonian records were made. This has to be borne in mind in connection with the present mental status of man, particularly in his outlook upon nature. In his thoughts and in his attributes, mankind at large is controlled by inherited beliefs and impulses, which countless thousands of years have ingrained like instinct. Over vast regions of the earth today, magic, amulets, charms, incantations are the chief weapons of defense against a malignant nature. And in disease, the practice of ASA is comparatively novel and unusual. In days of illness, many millions more still seek their gods rather than the physicians. In an upward path, man has had to work out for himself a relationship with his fellows and with nature. He sought in the supernatural an explanation of the pressing phenomena of life, peopling the world with spiritual beings, deifying objects of nature, and assigning to them benign or malign influences, which might be invoked or propitiated. Primitive priest, physician, and philosopher were one, and struggled on the one hand, for the recognition of certain practices forced on him by experience, and on the other, for the recognition of mystical agencies which control the dark, uncharted region about him, to use Professor Gilbert Murray's phrase, and were responsible for everything he could not understand, and particularly for the mysteries of disease. Pliny remarks that physic was early fathered upon the gods, and to the ordinary non-medical mind, there is still something mysterious about sickness, something outside the ordinary standard. Modern anthropologists claim that both religion and medicine took origin in magic, that spiritual protoplasm, as Miss Jane Harrison calls it. To primitive man, magic was the setting in motion of a spiritual power to help or to hurt the individual, and early forms may still be studied in the native races. This power, or mana, as it is called, while possessed in a certain degree by all, may be increased by practice. Certain individuals come to possess it very strongly. Among native Australians today, it is still deliberately cultivated. Magic in healing seeks to control the demons or forces causing disease, and in a way it may be thus regarded as a lineal ancestor of modern science, Wetham, which too seeks to control certain forces no longer, however, regarded as supernatural. Primitive man recognized many of these superhuman agencies relating to disease, such as the spirits of the dead, either human or animal, independent disease demons, or individuals who might act by controlling the spirits or agencies of disease. We see this today among the Negroes of the southern states. A hoodoo put upon a Negro may, if he knows of it, work upon him so powerfully through the imagination that he becomes very ill indeed, and only through a more powerful magic exercised by someone else can the hoodoo be taken off. To primitive man, life seemed full of sacred presences, Walter Pater, connected with objects in nature, or with incidents and epics in life, which he began early to deify, so that until a quite recent period, his story is largely associated with a pantheon of greater and lesser gods, which he has manufactured wholesale. Xenophanes was the earliest philosopher to recognize man's practice of making gods in his own image and endowing them with human faculties and attributes. The Thracians, he said, made their gods blue-eyed and red-haired, the Ethiopians, snub-nosed and black, while if oxen and lions and horses had hands and could draw, they would represent their gods as oxen and lions and horses. In relation to nature and to disease, all through early history, we find a pantheon full to repletion, bearing testimony no less to the fertility of man's imagination than to the hopes and fears which led him, in his exodus from barbarism, to regard his gods as pillars of fire by night and pillars of cloud by day. Even so late a religion as that of Numa was full of little gods to be invoked on special occasions. Vatican, who causes the infant to utter his first cry, Fabulinus, who prompts his first word, Huba, who keeps him quiet in his cot, Domaduca, who watches over one's safe homecoming, Walter Pater, and Numa believed that all diseases came from the gods and were to be averted by prayer and sacrifice. Besides the major gods, representatives of Apollo, Aesculapius, and Minerva, there were scores of lesser ones who could be invoked for special diseases. It is said that the young Roman mother might appeal to no less than 14 goddesses, from Juno Lucina to Prosa and Portforta, Withington. Temples were erected to the goddess of fever, and she was much invoked. There is extant a touching tablet, erected by a mourning mother, and inscribed, Fabri Divi, Fabri. Sancta, Fabri Magne. Camillo Amato Pro. Filio Meld Effecto. Posuit. It is marvelous what a long line of superhuman powers, major and minor, man has invoked against sickness. In Swinburne's words, God by God flits past in thunder till his glories turn to shades. God by God bears wondering witness how his gospel flames and fades. More was each of these, while yet they were than man there. Servant seemed. Dead are all of these, and man survives who made them, while he dreamed. Most of them have been benign and helpful gods. Into the dark. Chapters relating to demonical possession and to witchcraft we cannot here enter. They make one cry out with Lucretius, B.K. V. O genus in felix humanum, talia divis. Cum tribuit facta, at qui iras adjunxit acerbas. Quantos tum gemitus ipsi sibi, quantac nobis. Vulnera, quas lacrimas pepperere minoribu, nostris. In every age and in every religion there has been justification for his bitter words, tantum religio patuit suadere malorum. Such wrongs religion in her train doth bring, yet, one outcome of a belief in spiritual beings, as Tyler defines religion, has been that man has built an altar of righteousness in his heart. The comparative method applied to the study of his religious growth has shown how man's thoughts have widened in the unceasing purpose which runs through his spiritual no less than his physical evolution. Out of the spiritual protoplasm of magic have evolved philosopher and physician, as well as priest. Magic and religion control the uncharted sphere, the supernatural, the superhuman. Science seeks to know the world, and through knowing to control it. Ray Lankester remarks that man is nature's rebel, and goes on to say, the mental qualities which have developed in man, though traceable in a vague and rudimentary condition in some of his animal associates, are of such an unprecedented power and so far dominate everything else in his activities as a living organism that they have to a very large extent, if not entirely, cut him off from the general operation of that process of natural selection and survival of the fittest which up to their appearance had been the law of the living world. They justify the view that man forms a new departure in the gradual unfolding of nature's predestined scheme. Knowledge, reason, self-consciousness, will, are the attributes of man. It has been a slow and gradual growth, and not until within the past century has science organized knowledge, so searched out the secrets of nature, as to control her powers, limit her scope, and transform her energies. The victory is so recent that the mental attitude of the race is not yet adapted to the change. A large proportion of our fellow creatures still regard nature as a playground for demons and spirits to be exorcised or invoked. Side by side, as substance and shadow, in the dark backward and abysm of time, in the dawn of the great civilizations of Egypt and Babylon, in the bright morning of Greece, and in the full noontide of modern life, together have grown up these two diametrically opposite views of man's relation to nature, and more particularly, of his personal relation to the agencies of disease. The purpose of this course of lectures is to sketch the main features of the growth of these two dominant ideas, to show how they have influenced man at the different periods of his evolution, how the lamp of reason, so early lighted in his soul, burning now bright, now dim, has never, even in his darkest period, been wholly extinguished, but retrimmed and refurnished by his indomitable energies, now shines more and more towards the perfect day. It is a glorious chapter in history, in which those who have eyes to see may read the fulfillment of the promise of Eden, that one day man should not only possess the earth, but that he should have dominion over it. I propose to take an aeroplane flight through the centuries, touching only on the tall peaks from which may be had a panoramic view of the epochs through which we pass. End of the chapter. Chapter 2: Origin of Medicine. Medicine arose out of the primal sympathy of man with man, out of the desire to help those in sorrow, need, and sickness. In the primal sympathy, which having been must ever be. In the soothing thoughts that spring out of human suffering. The instinct of self-preservation, the longing to relieve a loved one, and above all, the maternal passion, for such it is, gradually softened the hard race of man, tum genus humanum primum mollicere coepit. In his marvelous sketch of the evolution of man, nothing illustrates more forcibly the prescience of Lucretius than the picture of the growth of sympathy, when with cries and gestures they taught with broken words that 'tis right for all men to have pity on the weak. I heard the well-known medical historian, the late Dr. Payne, remark that the basis of medicine is sympathy and the desire to help others, and whatever is done with this end must be called medicine. The first lessons came to primitive man by injuries, accidents, bites of beasts and serpents, perhaps for long ages not appreciated by his childlike mind, but little by little, such experiences crystallized into useful knowledge. The experiments of nature made clear to him the relation of cause and effect, but it is not likely, as Pliny suggests, that he picked up his earliest knowledge from the observation of certain practices in animals, as the natural phlebotomy of the plethoric hippopotamus, or the use of emetics from the dog, or the use of enemata from the ibis. On the other hand, Celsus is probably right in his account of the origin of rational medicine. Some of the sick, on account of their eagerness, took food on the first day, some on account of loathing abstained, and the disease in those who refrained was more relieved. Some ate during a fever, some a little before it, others after it had subsided, and those who had waited to the end did best. For the same reason, some at the beginning of an illness used a full diet, others a spare, and the former were made worse. Occurring daily, such things impressed careful men, who noted what had best helped the sick, then began to prescribe them. In this way, medicine had its rise from the experience of the recovery of some, of the death of others, distinguishing the hurtful from the salutary things. Book 1. The association of ideas was suggestive. The plant eyebright was used for centuries in diseases of the eye, because a black speck in the flower suggested the pupil of the eye. The old herbals are full of similar illustrations upon which, indeed, the so-called doctrine of signatures depends. Observation came, and with it an ever-widening experience. No society so primitive without some evidence of the existence of a healing art, which grew with its growth and became part of the fabric of its organization. With primitive medicine, as such, I cannot deal, but I must refer to the oldest existing evidence of a very extraordinary practice, that of trephining. Neolithic skulls with discs of bone removed have been found in nearly all parts of the world. Many careful studies have been made of this procedure, particularly by the great anatomist and surgeon, Paul Broca, and M. Lucas Championnier has covered the subject in a monograph. Broca suggests that the trephining was done by scratching or scraping, but as Lucas Championnier holds, it was also done by a series of perforations made in a circle with flint instruments and a round piece of skull in this way removed. Traces of these drill holes have been found. The operation was done for epilepsy, infantile convulsions, headache, and various cerebral diseases believed to be caused by confined demons to whom the hole gave a ready method of escape. The practice is still extant. Lucas Championnier saw a Kabyle Thaubib who told him that it was quite common among his tribe. He was the son of a family of trephiners and had undergone the operation 4 times, his father 12 times. He had 3 brothers also experts. He did not consider it a dangerous operation. He did it most frequently for pain in the head, and occasionally for fracture. The operation was sometimes performed upon animals. Shepherds trephined sheep for the staggers. We may say that the modern decompression operation, so much in vogue, is the oldest known surgical procedure. End of the chapter. Chapter 3: Egyptian Medicine. Out of the ocean of oblivion, man emerges in history in a highly civilized state on the banks of the Nile, some 60 centuries ago. After millenniums of a gradual upward progress, which can be traced in the records of the Stone Age, civilization springs forth Minerva-like, complete, and highly developed, in the Nile Valley. In this sheltered, fertile spot, Neolithic man first raised himself above his kindred races of the Mediterranean basin, and it is suggested that by the accidental discovery of copper, Egypt forged the instruments that raised civilization out of the slough of the Stone Age, Elliot Smith. Of special interest to us is the fact that one of the best-known names of this earliest period is that of a physician, guide, philosopher, and friend of the king, a man in a position of wide trust and importance. On leaving Cairo to go up the Nile, one sees on the right in the desert behind Memphis a terraced pyramid 190 feet in height, the first large structure of stone known in history. It is the royal tomb of Zoser, the first of a long series with which the Egyptian monarchy sought to adorn the coming bulk of death. The design of this is attributed to Imhotep, the first figure of a physician to stand out clearly from the mists of antiquity. In priestly wisdom, in magic, in the formulation of wise proverbs, in medicine and architecture, this remarkable figure of Zoser's reign left so notable a reputation that his name was never forgotten. In 2,500 years after his death, he had become a god of medicine, in whom the Greeks who called him Eyemouths recognized their own Aesculapius. He became a popular god, not only healing men when alive, but taking good care of them in the journeys after death. The facts about this Medicini Primus inventor, as he has been called, may be gathered from Kurt Setha's study. He seems to have corresponded very much to the Greek Asclepios. As a god, he is met with comparatively late, between 700 and 332 BC, numerous bronze figures of him remain. The oldest memorial mentioning him is a statue of one of his priests, Amasis, number 14,765 in the British Museum. Ptolemy V dedicated to him a temple on the island of Philae. His cult increased much in later days, and a special temple was dedicated to him near Memphis. Setha suggests that the cult of Imhotep gave the inspiration to the Hermetic literature. The association of Imhotep with the famous temple at Edfu is of special interest. Egypt became a center from which civilization spread to the other peoples of the Mediterranean. For long centuries, to be learned in all the wisdom of the Egyptians meant the possession of all knowledge. We must come to the land of the Nile for the origin of many of man's most distinctive and highly cherished beliefs. Not only is there a magnificent material civilization, but in records so marvelously preserved in stone, we may see, as in a glass, here clearly, there darkly, the picture of man's search after righteousness, the earliest impressions of his moral awakening, the beginnings of the strife in which he has always been engaged for social justice and for the recognition of the rights of the individual. But above all, earlier and more strongly than in any other people, was developed the faith that looked through death, to which, to this day, the noblest of their monuments bear an enduring testimony. With all this, it is not surprising to find a growth in the knowledge of practical medicine. But Egyptian civilization illustrates how crude and primitive may remain a knowledge of disease when conditioned by erroneous views of its nature. At first, the priest and physician were identified, and medicine never became fully dissociated from religion. Only in the later periods did a special group of physicians arise who were not members of priestly colleges. Maspero states that the Egyptians believed that disease and death were not natural and inevitable, but caused by some malign influence which could use any agency, natural or invisible, and very often belonged to the invisible world. Often, though, it belongs to the invisible world, and only reveals itself by the malignity of its attacks. It is a god, a spirit, the soul of a dead man that has cunningly entered a living person, or that throws itself upon him with irresistible violence. Once in possession of the body, the evil influence breaks the bones, sucks out the marrow, drinks the blood, gnaws the intestines and the heart, and devours the flesh. The invalid perishes according to the progress of this destructive work, and death speedily ensues, unless the evil genius can be driven out of it before it has committed irreparable damage. Whoever treats a sick person has therefore two equally important duties to perform. He must first discover the nature of the spirit in possession and, if necessary, its name, and then attack it, drive it out, or even destroy it. He can only succeed by powerful magic, so he must be an expert in reciting incantations and skillful in making amulets. He must then use medicine, drugs, and diet to contend with the disorders which the presence of the strange being has produced in the body. In this way, it came about that diseases were believed to be due to hostile spirits or caused by the anger of a god, so that medicines, no matter how powerful, could only be expected to assuage the pain. But magic alone, incantations, spells, and prayers, could remove the disease. Experience brought much of the wisdom we call empirical, and the records, extending for thousands of years, show that the Egyptians employed emetics, purgatives, enemata, diuretics, diaphoretics, and even bleeding. They had a rich pharmacopoeia derived from the animal, vegetable, and mineral kingdoms. In the later periods, specialism reached a remarkable development, and Herodotus remarks that the country was full of physicians. One treats only the diseases of the eye, another those of the head, the teeth, the abdomen, or the internal organs. Our knowledge of Egyptian medicine is derived largely from the remarkable papyri dealing specially with this subject. Of these, six or seven are of the first importance. The most famous is that discovered by Ebers, dating from about 1500 BC. A superb document, one of the great treasures of the Leipzig Library, it is 20.23 meters long and 30 centimeters high, and in a state of wonderful preservation. Others are the Cahoon, Berlin, Hearst, and British Museum papyri. All these have now been published, the last three quite recently, edited by Reshinsky. I show here a reproduction, from which an idea may be had, of these remarkable documents. They are motley collections, filled with incantations, charms, magical formulae, symbols, prayers, and prescriptions for all sorts of ailments. One is impressed by the richness of the pharmacopoeia, and the high development which the art of pharmacy must have attained. There were gargles, salves, snuffs, inhalations, suppositories, fumigations, enemata, poultices, and plasters, and they knew the use of opium, hemlock, the copper salts, squills, and castor oil. Surgery was not very highly developed, but the knife and actual cautery were freely used. Ophthalmic surgery was practiced by specialists, and there are many prescriptions in the papyri for ophthalmia. One department of Egyptian medicine reached a high stage of development, viz., hygiene. Cleanliness of the dwellings, of the cities, and of the person was regulated by law, and the priests set a splendid example in their frequent ablutions, shaving of the entire body, and the spotless cleanliness of their clothing. As Diodorus remarks, so evenly ordered was their whole manner of life that it was as if arranged by a learned physician rather than by a lawgiver. Two worldwide modes of practice found their earliest illustration in ancient Egypt. Magic, the first of these, represented the attitude of primitive man to nature, and really was his religion. He had no idea of immutable laws, but regarded the world about him as changeable and fickle like himself, and to make life go as he wished, he must be able to please and propitiate, or to coerce these forces outside himself. The point of interest to us is that in the pyramid texts, the oldest chapter in human thinking, preserved to us, the remotest reach in the intellectual history of man which we are now able to discern, One of their sixfold contents relates to the practice of magic. A deep belief existed as to its efficacy, particularly in guiding the dead, who were said to be glorious by reason of mouths equipped with the charms.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.